Do you remember book 6 of the Iliad, with Hector and his wife showing us through their dialogue and their behavior how deep and how true their love for each other is? With Odysseus and Penelope here in the Odyssey, we get to see what it would have looked like had Hector come home. Hello and welcome, or welcome back. My name is Zachary May, and today we are reading the great books of Western civilization, continuing with the Odyssey. This is the Robert Fagles translation, book 23, and as always, I'll begin with a brief plot summary before we get into the analysis and commentary. Eurycleia arrives at Penelope's room and tells her that Odysseus, who was the beggar all along, has returned home and has just finished killing the suitors. Penelope thinks that Eurycleia has lost it, but she eventually agrees to come downstairs, though cautiously, untrusting, believing that if anyone has killed the suitors, a god has. Telemachus is scandalized at his mother's unbelief, but she goes on to explain that if he truly is Odysseus, they will come to know each other in time, through secrets known only to the other. Odysseus himself affirms this and directs his son to help him figure out how they will deal with the great army of suitors' families that's surely coming to get them in the meantime. They decide together that it's best to clean themselves up and to have the bard begin playing a happy song in the halls so that any passerby will think that there's been a wedding recently rather than a slaughter. They will then retreat to the countryside tomorrow. This ruse works for the day. Odysseus finally confronts Penelope for her unbelief and asks the nurse to make up a bed for him by himself, apart, until his wife comes around. Penelope admits that the man before her looks quite a bit like her husband, but also affirms his request to the nurse. She asks that the bed in her room be dragged out for Odysseus to sleep on. Odysseus is angry and puzzled by this. No one could move his bed, the bed that he built himself, because the bedpost is in fact the living trunk of an olive tree that grows up through the house and into the bedroom. As he says this, he realizes that this was her test of his identity, and so he asks if his answer will satisfy her. Penelope rushes to Odysseus as she finally accepts that it is surely him. She explains that she had feared that some imposter might come and pretend to be him. The two lovers weep together as they embrace. Athena holds back the night and then the dawn to allow them as much time as they need to each share their long stories, love, and sleep. They awake the next morning, and Odysseus tells his wife that while there's still much to do to set all in his home to rights, first, he has to go and tell his father that he is home, and then deal with the suitors' families. She should stay in her room and not answer for anyone, just in case the mob comes for her. After all, surely the suitors' families have found out by now what has happened. He departs to the countryside with Telemachus, the swineherd, and the cowherd, all armed and armored. But now, since you have revealed such overwhelming proof, you've conquered my heart at last. The more she spoke, the more a deep desire for tears welled up inside his breast. He wept as he held the wife he loved, the soul of loyalty, in his arms at last. Joy, warm as the joy that shipwrecked sailors feel when they catch sight of land. Poseidon has struck their well-rigged ship on the open sea with gale winds and crushing walls of waves, and only a few escape, swimming, struggling out of the frothing surf to reach the shore, their bodies crusted with salt, but buoyed up with joy as they plant their feet on solid ground again, spared a deadly fate. So joyous now to her, the sight of her husband, vivid in her gaze. Did you notice how that metaphor is actually a review of Odysseus's actual travels? Because he was shipwrecked, not once, but twice, and one of them Poseidon was directly responsible for. And recall his joy as he reached the land of Phaeacia, swimming for his life out of the wreck. The joy he felt at getting one step closer to home. We get from this that she is just as filled with joy as he is at their reunion. If he had to deal with a physical sea and physical isolation and trial, she had to deal with emotional ones. Second of all, he is actually overjoyed to see her. He has spoken about many different things that he hopes to see again during his travels, such as his homeland, his parents. He names Ithaca, he directly refers to loved ones, and yes, once he says his faithful wife when he's departing from Phaeacia. But because it's usually something different said every time, I felt almost as though his urge to get back to Penelope was underemphasized. Remember how Calypso says that Penelope couldn't possibly compare to her, a goddess? And Odysseus not only admits it, he doesn't really offer a silver lining either. He just says, "Nevertheless, I long to travel home and see the dawn of my return." Ouch! However, he proves with his actions along the way that he truly does yearn for her, as is already known to Calypso, which we can see in her dialogue. Much as you long to see your wife, the one you pine for all your days. In any case, seeing Odysseus say this was something of a relief. Home at last, for her, after bearing 20 years of brutal struggle. When looking at Penelope's skepticism about Odysseus's identity, I find it helpful to consider a few things. First, it's been 20 years. He probably doesn't look the same as he did when he left. Second, they didn't have photographs or even paintings that could accurately capture a person's likeness. So without those things, how long do you think you could remember exactly what somebody looked like? Penelope seems to take this limitation of the human mind for granted. After all, it's only the knowledge of their secret signs that causes her to give in. And you know, she's right to be cautious. Knox relates her fear to the story of Martin Guerre from the 16th century. Look it up. Point being, somebody who looks enough like another person could even fool their spouse. But in any case, be aware that this is not the same thing as her doubt and despair about Odysseus being alive prior to now. When Eurycleia first breaks the news, she jumps for joy and believes it in her heart. She's just being cautious. And like I said, she's right to be. There is so much that Odysseus and Penelope get to experience together in this chapter that just brings a smile to your face. Athena holds back the night and then the dawn so that they can share their stories and basically try to catch up on 20 years of marriage spent apart as much as can be hoped for. However, the passage that really moved me the most came from Eurycleia, who tells us the reality of the situation. So now, after all the years of grief, you too can embark, loving hearts, along the road to joy. Look, your dreams, put off so long, come true at last. He's back alive, home at his hearth, and found you, found his son, still here. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please like it and subscribe to the channel. Also, comment down below and let me know what was the sweetest part of this chapter, in your opinion. Thanks, and I'll see you in the next video.